Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Checkerboard Kids Show. I'm your humble host, Checkerphil, and today I have a very special guest for you, representing for the 45th anniversary of the superhero Underdog. We have today Suzanne Muldowney. Let's hear it for her, ladies and gentlemen. Come on, let's hear it. Give it up. No, you can clap. Don't be ashamed. Hi, Suzanne.
Hello.
How are you doing today?
Well, I'm all excited and happy about the milestone 45th anniversary.
Right on. So what kind of festivities are going on for Underdog's birthday?
Well, first let me say, the cartoon show premiered October 3rd, 1964. So October 3rd this year is exactly 45 years. Well, to mark the occasion, there's a film and dance celebration in Ocean City, New Jersey.
Wow, I'm sure there's a lot of people are going to be representing there. And you will be performing, I assume?
Yes.
Excellent. And you'll be performing here, too, on Checkerboard Kids.
Well, we're showing, in Ocean City, we're showing the documentary, My Life as an Underdog. We're also supposed
to show... It's a great film. I'd like to plug right there, ladies and gentlemen.
We're also supposed to show some of the original Underdog cartoons.
Wow.
And of course, I'll be dancing.
Excellent. Well, okay, so what are you going to be dancing for us today, here at the studio?
My first number is one that I made up for... a feature-length Underdog story I wrote more than, 25 years ago. He's involved in deep space Olympics, and the villain has supposedly finished him off, but his corpse disappears, and then in the middle of one of the game sessions, all of a sudden he turns up unexpectedly.
Right, and this what is this called? What you wrote. This is the Space Olympics horror?
Interplanetary Olympic horror.
And you know, this is available actually on the Underdog Suzanne Muldowney website, which is muldowneyville.tripod. What's the website here? Can I get the lower there?
muldowneyville/tripod.com.
Right on. So you could download a copy of your script and they could read it. Good stuff. It's well written. It's a very lofty piece. I like it.
Well, it's long enough for an average to slightly longer than average length movie.
Right on. Okay, cool. And so what is the musical number that will be accompanying?
It's the last movement of Gustav Mahler's First Symphony.
I see. All right, so looking forward to it. And this piece is called?
Well, the style of movement that I made of Spotlight Spacewalk Allegro.
Okay, thank you. All right, looking forward. Spotlight Spacewalk Allegro, ladies and gentlemen. Enjoy it. Suzanne Muldowney, ladies and gentlemen. Let's hear it for her. Thank you. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Phil from Checkerboard Kids here representing the play. That was some excellent dancing. I tell you, from Suzanne Muldowney on Underdog's 45th anniversary. And what do I behold over here besides this fistful of forks I have, but this lovely cake designed by Suzanne Muldowney herself. So let's bring Suzanne Muldowney over to come take a look and talk about this. Hey, Suzanne, how are you doing?
All right.
That was a great performance you just did.
Half the time, I didn't think I was dancing up to par. I had to utilize the space as best I could.
Of course. Now, what about this cake? This cake is blue.
Well, if any of you know about your symbols for milestone anniversaries, the 45th anniversary is marked by sapphires.
Sapphires?
Well, you've seen jewels that look like colored glass, rubies, emeralds, diamonds, topazes, turquoises, sapphires. Well, sapphires are dark blue, like Underdog's cape.
I see. Okay, and you've made this thing, you made the icing from scratch, I hear?
Yes, I did.
And how about this Underdog? Is it edible, too?
No, that was a figurine you gave me some time back. I forget which anniversary it was, but it was for another milestone anniversary.
Right on. So are we going to be cutting the cake? And oh, actually, we're going to be talking about the episode that had Underdog's birthday in it, right?
There was one cartoon episode that did involve celebrating Underdog's birthday, yes.
Mm-hmm. But did you feel that it was not done properly?
There were very many mistakes in it.
Uh-huh. Like, such as?
Well, the name of it was Pain Strikes Underdog. Now, Underdog was assigned to guard a shipload of medieval collector's swords to a San Francisco museum. The swords were loaded aboard a train on the East Coast and headed west towards San Francisco, but Riff Raff, one of the repeat adversaries, derailed the train so that he could steal the sword collection. Underdog confronted him, and they dueled briefly, and Riff Raff ran away. When Underdog stooped down to put the train back on the tracks, all of a sudden, ah! When I stand straight, I'm right as rain, but when I bend over, there's a stabbing pain. Those were his exact words. So what was the cause of the injury? They rushed him to a hospital, but then that's where the mistakes were. They did not make him change from his costume to a hospital gown. And a doctor supposedly poured in from all over the world, which would have taken time to find out the cause of the injury. It turned out that after Underdog unlawfully escaped from the hospital when he heard that Riff Raff had stolen the swords and was concealing them somehow and defeated him, then the police said one sword was missing, and it turned out to have been lodged in Underdog's cape all the time. So if Underdog had been made to change to a hospital gown right away, they would have found the sword immediately, and they would have subjected him to healing procedures.
Now, you also would rewrite this episode, and you said you had an idea of how it could have been done.
Let me have that. Well, the idea was I did revise all the original Underdog stories in my mind because of the lack of believability. Now, in the case of Pain Strikes Underdog, I would have had Underdog and Riff Raff still would have dueled, but then a couple of Riff Raff's minions would have turned Underdog around so that Riff Raff could make a run for him and jab into Underdog's
Hold
back.
Hold on, can I see that one more time? All right, how are they jabbing? How are they jabbing? Like jab? Like right.
That.
And you're gonna do a jabbing motion on this cake right here.
Well, not really a jab. I'll be slicing it.
Okay, so shall we sing?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Underdog. Happy birthday to you.
Wow, I couldn't even go that high, Suzanne. It's quite all right. But I'm looking forward to having this cake. And now to have the first slice of cake, I invite Underdog expert Michael Hayden. So let's have a hand for him. Come here. A round of applause. Here.
If I'm going to cut the cake, shouldn't I put my microphone?
Yeah, put your microphone down here. I'll hand it to Mr. Hyden. Hey, Mike, how are you doing?
Camera, can we get one last look at the intact cake before I cut it?
Ah, beautiful. That's a cake. Mmm, nice. Now, Mr. Hyden, you've been a fan of Underdog for a while, yes?
Yeah.
And you used to work on the Underdog website, and also the Underdog early newsletters, right?
Oh, yes, just like you did.
Right, true that. And
whatever happened to your partner here on Checkerboard Kids?
Oh, dude, let's not get a complex here. And now here's the slice of cake. Now, is there anything you'd like to say for Underdog's birthday here, you being this expert?
Well, what would you like me to say? I thought you were going to ask me questions.
Well, what was your favorite Underdog episode?
That's a good question. I don't know. I like the one where he went, he went to Mars.
Hey, let's get a close-up of this. Now, is it blue in the inside? It's blue in the inside. Look at that. Wow.
It's yellow with blue swirls.
All right.
Do we have any plates?
No, dude. Here, take a napkin. Go ahead. Take it.
For me?
Yes. Thank you. Here, enjoy. All right, so thanks. Go enjoy that slice of cake. Here's a fork. Here's a fork. Take a fork.
Thank you.
All right, and let the people upstairs know that we have cake. So send them down, and we'll have them come down. Hello, it's Phil from Checkerboard Kids once again here with the Underdog 45th Anniversary Spectacular. I'm here now with Suzanne Muldowney. How are you doing, Suzanne?
All right.
People seem to be really enjoying that cake.
Well, it's a basic vanilla cake, but what I did is, after I mixed the batter, I took part of it out, put blue food color in it, then I put it back in the original bowl, marbled it a bit, and then that's why the cake had all those blue streaks.
Ah, very interesting. Well done. And what is this next number you'll be doing?
Well, we'll start off with a commentary, a description of the costume as done when I used to do Underdog for science fiction convention masquerades. But then when we finish the commentary, then I'll be doing the music, which is the finale to The Firebird by Stravinsky. Actually, I used that music as background for my favorite Underdog cartoon adventure, Go Snow.
Ah, I see. Okay, so I'm looking forward to that. And then from there, we'll be wrapping up the episode. Do you have anything else that you'd like to say for this 45th anniversary of Underdog?
You have to remember that all the original Underdog stories were very lacking in believability. There were many camp and buffoonish flaws, much like the Batman TV series. And my family forced me to see only the worst in it, so it was my duty to make Underdog a more meritorious character because he was supposed to be a superhero.
Right, and let's not even go there with the Underdog movie. I remember I took you to go see that. How did you like that one, Suzanne?
It was terrible.
But you did like the flying aspects of it.
Well, that's what attracted me most to Underdog, because like Superman, he was an aerialist.
Mm-hmm. But the rest of the movie left you lacking, huh?
Well, they made a mistake by setting it in the present day instead of in the 60s.
Right on. Okay, well, looking forward to your dance. And everybody, make sure to get out there for Underdog's 45th anniversary, and we'll be back in 5 years for Underdog's 50th.
For the 50th anniversary, I've got to wear a gold cape.
Are you working on that one yet?
No, I know where I can find the basic materials, but I don't think I'll be starting on it for a while yet.
Okay, very well then. And all right, so make sure to go to the website, Muldowneyville. What's the Muldowney?
Trodpod.com.
Yeah, and you can see all sorts of cool Suzanne Muldowney stuff. We have it all there on the website. And also look for the movie, My Life is an Underdog.
Well, we'll be showing that at the Underdog 45th Anniversary Classic Celebration in Ocean City on Saturday, October 3rd.
Which is Underdog's anniversary to the date.
45 years to the day.
Yep, darn skippy. All right, in any case, everybody, I hope you have a great day and enjoy this lovely performance by Suzanne. Thank you.
There's no need to fear. Underdog is here. Yes, here he is once again. Like Superman, he has the power to fly. Our impersonator needs no headpiece or masks. Her own loose hair resembles Underdog's hound ears adequately. She's recreated the costume of the red boots, tights, and the red tunic with a white letter, U, on the chest. On her finger is the ring with the FDA-approved revitalizing agent. The blue cape is symbolically decorated after the old-time animation, when Underdog launched himself skyward or flew at very high speeds,
He left a trail of stars in his wake. And when he stood majestically erect, he radiated in light and energy as simulated thus. There's something noticeably different about the cape's decorations. Why the inside white rather than blue? Why so many blue jewels? Why the blue belt? Remember, it's the 45th anniversary. The symbol of that is sapphires, which are dark blue jewels. Our congrats to Underdog and his living embodiment, Suzanne Muldowney. Hey, Suzanne, that was a rather majestic Underdog 45th anniversary, wouldn't you say?
Yes, I must apologize for not wearing any shoes. I was just in my stocking feet. If I looked a little sloppy, it's because the floor was kind of slippery. But see, if I have my boots on a real long time, they hurt my feet.
Okay, well, we don't want you hurting your feet now. That's the important stuff. Now, Suzanne, we have a website that people can go to find out all the best we were talking about before, which is the Muldowneyville site. It's greetings from Muldowneyville, and it's what's the website, Suzanne? Go ahead.
Muldowneyville.tripod.com. I'm not sure if it's /tripod or .tripod. When I saw it on the monitor, it looked like a dot.
Well, if you do a search on it, on a search engine, you could find out where it is. So just put Muldowneyville in there, and you could find out all the up-to-date happenings with Suzanne Muldowney. You could find out her website. I mean, it is her website. But you could find out about where she's going to be performing, what different events you will be hitting up, right? Now, Suzanne, you've been doing a lot of radio lately. Is this true? How did that come about?
Someone named Tim Sabian called contacted me from Sirius Radio, and he offered me my own hour-long broadcast every once in a while, but I'm not very happy about it being kind of overshadowed by my vulgar nemesis, Stern.
Oh, why Stern is involved with the Sirius Radio? Well, you know, there's other people that are on Sirius too.
Well, they a lot of legitimate celebrities are on it, but some people give me a hard time because they say it's on Stern's channel.
Oh, well, you know, it is what it is. I know also Jake is also on Sirius Radio too. Jake Fogelness, if anybody knows Squirt, right? So tell me more about this radio. Do you get phone calls? You get phone callers in there?
We do get some incoming phone calls, yes.
Mm-hmm. And have they been, like, malicious people or friendly people? What are people like?
Well, the last time I did it, there were no prank calls.
Mm-hmm.
But it's an abuse of freedom of speech when a prank caller calls in.
So you're very anti-pranks, huh?
Well, I've been conspired against and molested and mistreated all my life.
You don't mean physically molested. You mean like
sometimes in college I was physically mistreated.
Oh, okay. Like some wild jocks or something like that throwing stuff and things like that.
No, they were other students and they had no manners. They assumed the right to make trouble for somebody who didn't seem to fit in with the rest of the
college.
What would they do?
They were not student council officers or any kind of students in authority. They were just ordinary students, and they were not faculty members.
Would they berate you or be mean, or what's their deal?
They would barge into my room, steal my property, and physically molest me.
Steal your property? What would they take? I mean, what are they looking at?
Well, one student admired this white leather skirt I had with fringe on the bottom. She said she wanted it, and I didn't know where she could get another like it. So one time she tricked the dormitory monitor into giving her the main key so she could go into my room and steal it. And then I couldn't figure out where to have it. And then one day she was parading around the hall wearing it, and I instantly recognized that she had stolen it, and she was forced to give it back.
And they gave it back?
Yeah, but the college didn't contact her parents or anything, or make her parents take action against her for what they'd done. None of the dormitory monitors, when they knew that other dormitory students were making trouble for me, ever contacted the malicious student's parents.
Now, is this the same one that tried to molest you too, or no?
It was a different one.
Okay. It was all girls, right?
It was a girls' college.
Okay, very good, very good. So it was no shady dealings. It was just somebody just barged in there and tried to bother you.
I suffered all the time I was in college because malicious dormitory students, and sometimes even commuter students too, assumed the right and authority to make trouble for me.
Oh, well, I'm glad you don't have to go through that now. Now you're your own woman. You have your own place, and people can't barge in.
Well, people who place prank phone calls to my radio station are still examples of discourtesy, and there are still some sites where I'm in parades where people make trouble for me. I risk being barred from future participation in parades because these harassers caused me to lose face with the organizers and the local police departments.
Wow. Okay. So, well, that's stuff to keep in mind. So, come on, mind your manners, guys. Very important stuff. Any other messages you have to give out to the people before we wrap up?
I said this about people making trouble for me. Don't be surprised if later on you pay a penalty when you least expect it. Grown-ups who were molesters risk their children continuing the tradition, and it would come back to haunt them because then you would have to take action. Children who are harassers now risk having their children being troublemakers, when they become parents. And then as parents, they'll receive the complaints and will have to take action. And don't forget, God is keeping watch and will give everybody their just desserts in the end.
So God will mete out justice in the end.
Yes.
So you hear that, guys? Better watch your act. So do the right thing. Don't front. And, be kind to your fellow person, man. Come on.
Because some people, when they bother me, demonstrate outwardly their disregard for the golden rule.
And the golden rule is?
Do unto others as you would have them do unto you.
Wow. All right. Well, that's good advice. I wonder who wrote that. No, I'm just kidding. Jesus wrote that. All right. So cool. So ladies and gentlemen, mind the golden rule, don't front, and have a very, very excellent Underdog 45th anniversary. So
coming. Underdog 45th anniversary classic.
Classic.